Hey, hi. Hi. Hey. It's really nice of you to come tonight. My name is Melissa Franklin. I'm a physicist. You can clap now. I'm really excited about this talk tonight. I just want to say that I invited Professor Oreskes to give this talk before the election. So obviously I'm brilliant. And I'm so happy that she's giving this talk tonight because it's so important, so incredibly important. This topic, the scientist is Sentinel, is probably the most important thing for a lot of us right now. What do we do? What do we do now? How do we make a contribution? Naomi Oreskes is kind of an interesting person. I've known her for just a little while because she arrived at Harvard just a few years ago as a professor in the History of Science department and in the Earth and Planetary Sciences department. And she's very cool, but most cool is that she got her degree from the School of Mines. I love School of Mines at the Imperial College in England, the place where there is now Brexit. And she left early and came back and went to Stanford University to do her PhD, but she didn't want to just do a normal PhD. She had to make it up herself, because it's not in just one department, which I also like. So I just like her a lot in many ways, but other than the incredible work she does right now, which is so important to us, is her work with the Pope. Sorry, I know that sounds funny, but she wrote an introduction to the encyclical on climate change and inequality with Pope Francis. I've never really worked with the Pope, but I hear he's a great guy, and I wish he'd asked me, and even though I don't know anything about anything really, about climate change. Also, she's just incredibly prolific. She wrote a book called, in 2014, called The Collapse of Western Civilization, which was a positive thing. And she's also given really good TED Talks, if you like that kind of thing. She's just an incredible historian, but also she knows science. And she also wrote some books that I don't even know. The words about, like, do we believe in climate change? That's really important. I think the thing that I am looking forward to tonight is hearing from a really sane person who's very creative, and she's going to tell us what to do. She's going to tell us what to do. So please welcome her.
Well, thank you for that great introduction. You know, one of the things I've always struggled with as a historian and philosopher of science who studies science and thinks about what scientists should do is, in my experience, most scientists do not want historians to tell them what to do. So I'm really, really happy that we've come to this moment. It's not turned on? I thought I turned it on.
Did you? Okay.
Okay. We've come to this moment where a physicist wants me to tell her what to do. That's pretty special. I also thank you for that generous introduction. When I was studying at the Royal School of Mines, which is part of Imperial College London, and people would ask me where I went to school, and I would say, I go to the Royal School of Mines, and they would say, the Royal School of Mines? Are you studying philosophy? So, yes, the Royal School of Mines. I studied mining geology. Also, when you said I'm very interesting, my mother is the kindest, sweetest person on earth and never, ever, ever likes to say anything bad about anyone. But if you put on an article of clothing that she thinks is a little not so flattering, she'll say, oh, that's interesting. So my family being interesting is not necessarily a compliment, but I will take it as a compliment here tonight. So what I want to talk to you tonight about is work I've actually been doing for a number of years about this question of what the role of scientists should really be in relation to talking about contested public policy issues. I developed this specific talk for AAAS that was here in Boston last month. I had the honor to do a keynote speech talk there. So I developed this talk as a talk about science for scientists. So in this talk, I'm going to use the word we when I refer to scientists. For those of you who aren't scientists, you can just say they. But the message, I think, is relevant for all of us in thinking through what our role needs to be in terms of thinking about contested issues of public policy. So some of you may have, and I'm going to come out from behind this podium because I don't like podiums. I don't like to be separated from my people. So some of you may have seen this that ran in the New Yorker a few weeks ago. Those smug pilots have lost touch with regular passengers like us. Who thinks I should fly the plane? Now, of course, we all laugh at that because to us it's obvious that the public ignores expertise at its peril. And as people associated with a great university like Harvard, we have an expectation that our expertise should be respected and in many cases acted on. But as we've seen of late, many of our political leaders not only don't act on our expertise, but they actually reject it. And in some cases, they actively misrepresent it. And that creates a very difficult situation for us. What should we do when our work, our expertise, is being rejected, disparaged, and in some cases misrepresented? Should we speak up in public? Should we be speaking up in public on tricky, sensitive topics like evolution or the safety of vaccinations or, in my case, climate change? And if so, how? And what exactly does it mean to say that we should respect expertise? What are the boundaries of expertise? And if we, as experts, embrace a public role, what does that entail? So I want to start by talking about a scientist that I've studied in some detail, a man by the name of Roger Revell. How many of you have heard of Revell before? Oh, a lot. Wow, this is a great audience. Okay. And not just the earth science professors. So Revell, as many of you know, is a very famous chemical oceanographer. He was also one of the directors of the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in San Diego, and he was also the mentor to Al Gore. It's because of Roger Revell that Al Gore first learned about climate change and began to think of it about it as a serious issue. In 1965, Revell was serving as part of the President's Science Advisory Committee, a group that was writing a report on the state of the environment. And this report had an appendix that was co-authored with four of his prominent geoscientific colleagues, including Dave Keeling. And the title of this appendix was Atmospheric CO2, the Invisible Pollutant. And in this appendix, Revell and his colleagues warned that in due course, not tomorrow, not next year, but in due course, increased atmospheric carbon dioxide would likely alter the climate in serious and adverse ways. They wrote, throughout his worldwide industrial civilization, man is unwittingly conducting a vast geophysical experiment. By the year 2000, the increase in atmospheric CO2 will be close to 25%. This may be sufficient to produce measurable and perhaps marked changes in climate. And as we all know today now, that prediction came true. So we can say that these leading scientists of a previous generation were acting as sentinels. They were calling attention to an issue that was not yet publicly recognized, in fact, not even recognized by most of their scientific colleagues at this time. And they were pointing out that while the issue of visible pollution was getting a lot of attention in the media and in halls of power, particularly smog in Los Angeles or the terrible London fogs that had killed people in the 1950s, there were other invisible pollutants that were also important. And carbon dioxide was probably the most important of these invisible pollutants. So they reached out to political leaders, in this case to the President of the United States, about their scientific research that implied a societal threat. Now, in our research in the Revell archives, we've never found any evidence that Revell worried that this might somehow not be an appropriate thing to do. On the contrary, in the context of growing public concern about air pollution in the 1960s, Revell considered it to be obviously appropriate to alert political leaders to this other form of pollution that was not as obvious but could also have serious long-term effects. We also have seen from our research that most of the political leaders to whom he reached out did seem to be at least cautiously receptive to being made aware of this issue. And in current research that I'm doing here with two of my graduate students here at Harvard in the History of Science Department, Hannah Conway and Colleen Lanier Christensen, we've identified a number of political leaders in the 1960s who took an interest in this issue and who thanked Revel and his colleagues for sending these materials to them and in some cases followed up and asked for more information. So those were, it was a very different time. Now, today, though, many of us are reluctant to be sentinels. Many of us are worried that if we speak up in public, beyond the confines of scientific publications or scientific meetings and conferences, that this will lead to us being viewed as advocates or activists, and that we will politicize our science and will lose credibility. And many of you have heard this in the last few weeks. Maybe some of you have been involved in conversations with your students or your colleagues here at Harvard about whether we should participate in the March for Science and whether or not that threatens to politicize science in an undesirable way. So this is a question that colleagues and I have been looking at actually for a few years, well before the March on Science or March for Science or whatever. March on Science? No, I guess it's a March for Science. Donald Trump is marching on science. Well before the current political situation, my colleagues and I have been interested in this question of how scientists think about their role in relation to political questions. So I've been, for several years now, part of a project that's coming, wrapping up now, called Assessing Assessments. My colleagues on this are Dale Jamieson, who just talked at the law school today about other work, and Michael Oppenheimer and several other postdocs and graduate students. So in our work, this was one of the things that we asked scientists about. We asked them, how do you think about the relationship between science and policy, and how do you think about your role in relation to that question? And what we found was a very consistent pattern, where the vast majority of scientists that we asked expressed a great deal of reluctance to take on any role other than simply presenting factual information in the context of scientific assessments. So not expressing opinions on policy, and not even presenting those facts in other contexts outside of the assessment framework. And when we probed this and asked why, many expressed the idea that there is or needs to be a bright line between science on the one hand and policy on the other. And that speaking up in public, even about the facts, threatens to dull that line. And therefore, scientists said things like, well, you should do your work, but you should not go public. Some said, using an imperative, you must not go public. You must not cross the line. And when we said, well, why, they said, well, because if you do, you'll lose your credibility. The IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has addressed this issue explicitly through its rubric of being policy relevant but not policy prescriptive. IPCC leaders acknowledge that their work is not pure science, that climate science is linked to major public policy issues, and that the IPCC exists because of its link to governance through the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. But nevertheless, even though they acknowledge that the IPCC itself is a kind of hybrid organization, most climate scientists working within the IPCC still say that they should refrain from taking any kind of public role and stay removed from discussion of policy implications and considerations. And one of the most common refrains that we've heard, both in the context of this research and more broadly, is scientists saying that we should let the facts speak for themselves. Now, our climate science colleague, James Hansen, has also written about this issue, and he's referred to this as reticence. He said that scientists in general are reluctant to speak up about what they know about climate change. So not just about the policy things, but even to speak up in public about the facts. And again, because they believe that we need to let the facts speak for themselves. Now, those of you who saw the poster for this talk saw that one of the pictures on it is this picture of Jim Hansen getting arrested, protesting at the White House over the lack of action on climate change. Many scientists who we have spoken to have invoked Jim Hansen as proof. Now, Hansen has become a major figure not only because he speaks up about the evidence of climate change, which he does, but also because he's become an advocate for particular solutions. So he is an advocate for a carbon price established through a fee and dividend system. And in support of this work, he has been arrested several times. But I want to ask the question tonight, what exactly is Hansen proof of other than maybe that scientists are uncomfortable with his position. And it's not just climate science. This is an issue that affects scientists in many, many areas. So people who work in marine biology and conservation, people who study lead or other toxics in the environment, endocrine disrupting chemicals, neonicotinoid pesticides and their potential impacts on pollinators, genetically modified crops, vaccine safety, the harms of sugar in the American diet, deaths and injury from gun violence. All of these are issues on which scientists do scientific work, collect data, factual information, but they have policy implications that may be highly contested. So scientists in many fields face the Sentinel problem. And I want to argue that scientists in the past have faced this problem too, that although this moment we're living in may feel unique, it certainly feels distinctive and troubling in our lifetimes, but it isn't actually a unique moment in terms of scientists facing this question of what their role should be. So we could think of this problem as having a kind of spectrum of choices. At one end, we might say, as many scientists do say, that we should just do our science and leave it to others to communicate it, to explain why it matters, and where needed to propose remedies. And we could call this the pure science ideal. Excuse me. At the other end, we could think about Jim Hansen, who does speak out, does get involved, does propose remedies, and in his case, does even get arrested. We could call that the activist ideal. So what I want to do tonight is to argue for a middle ground. Now, as a person who works on climate change, I adamantly reject the idea that the truth is always in the middle, because it's often not. But tonight, I do want to suggest that there is a kind of middle ground that we might think about occupying. And that in any case, thinking about the spectrum helps us think about where we want to be on that spectrum, because at the end of the day, there isn't actually a right or wrong answer to this. These are judgments. But historical experience, historical evidence can help us make those judgments, and help us judge where we want to be in relation to this question. So my argument tonight has three parts. The first is to talk about historical precedent, to look at an example of scientists in the past who did step up and act as sentinels, not just on the fact of the problem, but also on policy solutions, and to argue that this precedent refutes our worry or our anxiety that taking a public position on an urgent issue undermines the credibility of our science, and then to argue, to conclude, that I do believe we need to speak because facts don't, in fact, speak for themselves. So what is the historical precedent? Well, some of you may already know, maybe you've heard me talk before, but it's the precedent of nuclear weaponry. Many climate scientists feel that we are today in an existential crisis. Scientists in 1945 knew that they were. There was no question among physicists who worked on the Manhattan Project, who worked on nuclear weapons, that the potential for an arms race meant the potential to eliminate life on Earth as we knew it. And in this context, particularly as 1945 became 1948 and the Soviet Union exploded its first hydrogen bomb, and then its atomic bomb, and then the United States developed a hydrogen bomb, and then the Soviet Union developed a hydrogen bomb, and pretty soon we were in an arms race. Many leading physicists felt that they had a moral obligation to speak out against nuclear proliferation. As many of you know, they had played an essential role in creating these weapons, and these weapons now threatened human safety and potentially even human survival. And therefore, they felt it was actually rather obvious that they had an obligation to raise an alarm and suggest means to control this threat. So drawing on the framework of scientific rationality, they argued that it was rational to be alarmed and irrational to be complacent. And therefore, they did have an obligation. But one of the interesting things about this discussion that takes place in the late 40s and 50s is that many of these physicists argue that their obligation is not just to speak up on the technical aspects of nuclear weaponry, to explain how they worked and how they killed people and why they were so damaging, but also to address the problem of what to do about them, about how to control them. Because to them, it was eminently clear that these things did need to be controlled. There was no real plausible argument that an unrestricted arms race would be a good thing for the world. The most famous example, as many of you know, is Niels Bohr, who spoke out actually even before the end of World War II and predicted the arms race that would follow if there were not some kind of international agreement between the US and the Soviet Union. and also Albert Einstein, who in later years famously became an advocate for international peace and arms control. But it wasn't just Bohr and Einstein. Sometimes people have said to me, well, Bohr could afford it, he was so famous, or Einstein could afford to speak out. But it wasn't just these incredibly conspicuously famous figures. Actually, a wide range of physicists, Hans Bethe, Leo Szilard, James Franck, Philip Morrison, who taught for many years at MIT, and many, many others. There are dozens of physicists that we could name who became involved in a variety of different ways, large and small, to help alert the world to the threat of nuclear weapons and engage people in a conversation about arms control and disarmament. These men spoke to the moral imperative to control nuclear weapons, and they became advocates. The core of their argument is something that I've labeled epistemic proximity. And I think it's an important argument to understand because it's not just about a kind of moral obligation that arose from having built the weapons, but it also has specifically to do with their role as they understand it as experts. So the argument goes like this. It's not just that they helped build these weapons, but it's that as physicists, they had a uniquely vivid appreciation and understanding of the damage that these weapons could wreak. That they could explain things that other people really didn't, and maybe even couldn't fully understand, about what an arms race and a large-scale nuclear exchange would really mean. So people had seen the destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. John Hersey had written about it very beautifully in his book, Hiroshima. But many people said, well, yes, it's true, lots of people died, but how is that worse or different than the firebombing in Dresden or the firebombing of Tokyo? So for many people, it wasn't actually clear why these weapons were substantially worse. Now, this seems hard to conceptualize today. And previously, the slide said, today, all the world leaders understand what a major nuclear explosion would do. OK, well, when you do contemporary history, you have to stay on your toes. But clearly, in the late 40s and 50s, that was not the case. Some of you may know that President Harry Truman, when confronted with the announcement of the Soviet atomic bomb, and when he was asked, well, does this mean there will be an arms race, he said, yes, and we will win it. Douglas MacArthur, during the Korean conflict, requested permission to use nuclear weapons. So it's not the case that people understood that using nuclear weapons would necessarily lead to some kind of terrible conflagration. So these scientists felt that the need to understand fully and viscerally what a large-scale nuclear exchange would mean, that this need was severe and that they had to step up to that challenge. And many of them did so in both public and private ways. So I think a comparable argument can be made about climate change today. I've given something like 300 public talks on climate change, and I've spoken, I'm going to South Dakota tomorrow, so I now will have been to 47 of 50 states, and I've talked in Idaho and North Dakota and Texas and Oklahoma and California. And one of the things that I feel I've learned is that many people, including many people who do not deny climate change or do not disparage climate science, still don't really quite get why this issue really matters. They don't quite understand just how serious uncontrolled climate change will be. One of my colleagues, a quite famous and distinguished political scientist, said to me once over lunch, so tell me why I should be worried about polar bears? And this is partly why Eric Conway and I wrote The Collapse of Western Civilization, because we were trying to think about what could we do, what kind of story could we tell that would convey to people why climate change really matters and why this is not just a question of polar bears, as much as I personally do love and worry about polar bears. OK, so part two. I want to argue that this historical precedent offers evidence that refutes our worry that taking a public position on an urgent issue will undermine our scientific credibility. And this argument is actually extremely short. The evidence simply doesn't support this hypothesis. If we think about Albert Einstein, I know of no evidence, and maybe someone can come up with it, but I know of no evidence that the theory of relativity or his work on the photoelectric effect ever lost credibility because of his advocacy of arms control. Now, there were anti-Semites in Germany who didn't like Einstein, but that was not because of his public advocacy. That was because of a whole set of other complicated issues. Hans Bethe, as many of you know, won the Nobel Prize for his work on nuclear fusion. No one ever suggested revoking that prize or that somehow that work was doubted or dubious because he was an arms control advocate. And Bohr is such an interesting character. Some of you know, Many of Bohr's colleagues were dubious about the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics. Bohr wrote a lot of philosophical essays that lots of his colleagues thought were completely off the rails. But it wasn't, but not his arms control advocacy. Millions of school children learned about the Bohr model of the atom. If you took high school physics or college physics, you learned about the liquid drop model of fission. You learned about his crucial scientific contributions. And no one ever said that those contributions were undermined because he advocated arms control. Now, what about Robert Oppenheimer? Some people say to me, well, what about Oppenheimer? Oppenheimer's, you know, a famous case of a scientist who got discredited. But what exactly happened to Oppenheimer? He lost his security clearance because of his opposition to the hydrogen bomb, and also because Edward Teller held a personal grudge against him and saw this as an opportunity to undermine him. So Oppenheimer lost political standing inside the US government. He lost his clearance. He lost his capacity to give advice to political leaders on certain delicate issues. But losing political standing with politicians is a very different thing than losing scientific credibility. And in fact, Oppenheimer became a hero in many circles. I mean, many of you have heard of Oppenheimer because of this, more than because of his science. So among many people, he gained credibility. So when we talk about credibility, we actually have to be more precise. We have to ask, are we talking about credibility with political leaders? Are we talking about credibility with the public? Are we talking about credibility with our own colleagues? You know, or what? These are different things. There's no evidence that Oppenheimer lost scientific credibility with any of his colleagues because of this work. So I want to argue that the fear of losing scientific credibility is exactly that. It's a fear. It's an anxiety. And there's actually very little evidence to support the worry. And you can call me naive, but I do think we should be making our decisions based on evidence, even though I know that's a very controversial claim to make in this day and age. And some of you may have seen that there's actually a study that just came out a couple weeks ago, and I apologize, I haven't had a time to make a slide of it, but a recent study that actually interviewed people of the public and, you know, posed to them some scenarios where scientists, you know, spoke out in public, made policy recommendations, actually showed that there's very little evidence to suggest that, this causes you to lose credibility with the public either. So it's actually an interesting question, and it will be a question for another talk, about actually why we are so worried about this issue when there's actually so little evidence to support it. But I haven't done that work to answer that question yet. Okay, so part three, facts don't speak for themselves. Well, why do I say that? Why don't facts speak for themselves? Well, the simple answer, and when I started saying this 7, 8, 9, 10 years ago, this was considered controversial. Now it seems obvious, so that's good. I can make the talk shorter. We live in a world where many people are trying to silence facts. And as you know, as many of us now understand, these arguments are not actually about the facts. They're not just about the facts, and in most cases, they're not even actually about the facts at all. Many of the arguments that are being used to undermine climate science, to be able to undermine evolution, to undermine vaccine safety, these are arguments about political beliefs, about economic interests, and about values. You cannot refute a claim about values with facts, or a claim about facts with values. That's what philosophers would call a category mistake, right? We're conflating two different domains. If people are rejecting climate science because of values, then we have to think about what those values are and why those values are perceived to be in conflict with our facts. And this was essentially the conclusion of the work I did with my colleague Eric Conway when we wrote the book Merchants of Doubt. When we started this project, we were frankly mystified. We had come across a story of some very famous scientists, scientists that we actually knew, one of whom had been the director of the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, where I was working at the time. And these prominent, distinguished, famous scientists had become climate change deniers. And there was no possibility that this was scientific illiteracy, because these were some of the most brilliant and successful scientists of the 20th century. It included Frederick Seitz, who was the president of the US National Academy of Sciences. So the question we had was, why would these people reject the scientific work of their own colleagues? How do you make sense of that? And what we found overwhelmingly, not just for these men that we studied in our book, but in general, that the rejection of climate scientific facts was not about scientific illiteracy or lack of scientific understanding, but actually it was driven by an anxiety, by a fear, by a worry, the worry that addressing climate change would lead to bigger government, higher taxes, and loss of personal freedom. And those concerns and the solutions that people were proposing for climate science were seen as clashing with conservative values. And that's why we've seen this enormous politicization of the issue, because of conservatives believing that the implications of climate science threaten their values. It's this clash of values then that explains the polarization and also some of the otherwise strange alliances that we see on this issue. The perception that addressing climate change will require big government or higher taxes explains a good deal of the political polarization around the issue, because opponents of big government are ideologically motivated to reject climate scientific evidence. And they've made common cause then with industries that reject the science because it threatens their profit. So the obvious part of this story, the economic motive, this economic self-interest, aligns with a more subtle and complicated story about people seeing climate science as clashing with and threatening their values. So just to sum this up, I want to show you a short clip from the film that we were made of our movie. And this is just kind of Merchants of Doubt in a nutshell that shows you who these people are and the sorts of arguments that they make to try to undermine scientific findings.
Bill O'Keefe is executive vice president of the American Petroleum Institute. He's also a board member of the Global Climate Coalition, made up of oil and electric companies, automakers, and others.
We believed it was a war on oil. They had an off-oil agenda. Climate change was part of that.
I think that it's unfortunate that the science is so distorted and misstated.
The science is complicated. There are lots of different factors, so you really have to understand the whole picture.
There is a natural variability that has nothing to do with man.
Climate is changing naturally.
It has to do with sunspots. It has to do with the wobble of the Earth.
And so it's not too difficult to persuade some of the public that we really don't know for sure. And so maybe let's wait a while. We need to have more proof.
We need more data. The science isn't there to make that determination.
There is no need for us to rush to this kind of judgment to respond.
Others put out ads saying more pollution is going to be good for us.
A doubling of the CO2 content of the atmosphere will produce a tremendous greening of planet Earth.
CO2 is a benefit to plant life. It's increasing the bounty and the productivity of the planet, our ability to feed populations in this world.
What you're seeing here from the coal industry is perfectly analogous to what the tobacco industry used to do. They refuse to change, refuse to shift, and they're trying to convince us that it's actually good for us, the way they used to say, luckies make you healthy.
Okay, so in that clip, you see sort of the basic, you see the merchants of doubt, you know, doing their thing. But in that clip, you're seeing people mostly who represent the fossil fuel industry. So Lee Raymond from ExxonMobil, Don Blankenship from Massey Energy, Bill O'Keefe from the American Petroleum Institute. But again, as I already mentioned, part of what we were trying to do in our work was to understand why would scientists, why would other people who don't have stock in ExxonMobil, why would they make common cause with this sort of work? And again, as I've already suggested, it's this confluence of money and ideology that explains the pattern that we saw. And this also helps to explain why climate change denial is so much more prevalent in the United States than elsewhere. Because of our powerful commitment to individualism in the United States, and the historic American skepticism about the federal government, going back to the founding of the Republican, skepticism about centralized decision making. And you know, if think about it, think about the Articles of Confederation, think about the separation of powers. This country was rooted in an idea that vesting too much power in centralized government would undermine the individual freedoms of the states and the people in them. We have a deeply rooted belief in the United States that the government that governs best governs least. And that's a belief that informs a huge amount of climate change denial. So climate skeptics, contrarians, deniers, whatever you want to call them, they play on these cultural norms, insisting that addressing climate change will lead to an expansion of the government and a constriction of our freedoms. And you've seen this kind of ideology on display in the last few weeks. And this resonates very strongly with many ordinary Americans, particularly in what we've come to call the red states. And therefore, people resist accepting the findings of climate science, and they're open to the suggestion that our findings are exaggerated or even perhaps a hoax. So I want to just give one example of how this works, and sort of one scientist that we studied that I think is a particularly illustrative example of how this ideological piece comes together with rejecting the findings of science. So one of the people that we studied was a physicist named Fred Singer, who some of you maybe are familiar with. Singer was not a climate scientist. He was a physicist. In fact, he was the proverbial rocket scientist. He was the first director of the U.S. Weather Satellite Service and was involved in the early years of the U.S. rocketry and space programs. But in addition to his scientific work, he was also involved in campaigns to challenge the scientific evidence of acid rain, of the ozone hole, of climate change, and also of the harms of tobacco. Fred Singer, in the early 1990s, worked with the Philip Morris Tobacco Company to attack the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency over the issue of secondhand smoke. Now, some of you know that we have known since the 1980s that secondhand smoke can cause cancer. The same chemicals that are in primary smoke also occur in the exhaled smoke or in smoke that comes from a cigarette that's just burning. And if you breathe that smoke, you also can be subject to cancer and many of the other diseases that affect smokers. This was first stated unequivocally in 1986 in a report of the US Surgeon General, in which the Surgeon General declared that involuntary smoking, that was the term he used, is a cause of disease, including lung cancer, in healthy non-smokers, especially children. And based on this, as well as an independent review of over 6,000 peer-reviewed scientific papers, in the early 1990s, the EPA declared secondhand smoke to be a Class A or proven carcinogen. In 1994, working with the tobacco industry, Fred Singer wrote a report attacking these scientific findings. And one of the reasons, this is a copy of out of the tobacco legacy documents of the cover page for this report. And I made this slide because Fred Singer is still alive, and he accused me of being a liar. He has said in public that he never worked with the tobacco industry. So, yeah, there it is. Okay, that's why I love documents, that's why I love my job. So Singer had been working as a consultant to Philip Morris, and he was hooked up, I'm not sure exactly how, but he started working with a lawyer named Kent Jeffries, a lawyer who was affiliated with the Cato Institute and the Competitive Enterprise Institute. And some of you know, these are think tanks that promote free market solutions to social policy problems. The report was actually published by the Alexis de Tocqueville Institute, but funded by the Tobacco Institute, which was the so-called research arm of the tobacco industry. So this report illustrates in a nutshell how this works. There's a kind of shell game where the tobacco industry would give money to the Tobacco Institute, claiming that that was for research. Tobacco Institute would hire lawyers out of think tanks like the Cato Institute. They would then work with a scientist who would give the thing scientific credibility and produce a report that would be issued by yet another think tank, in this case the Alexis de Tocqueville Institute, whose name would conjure up notions of freedom and democracy in America. Now, the interest of the tobacco industry in attacking the EPA is obvious, and I think the interest of these think tanks in opposing regulation is nearly as obvious. But why would a physicist attack the scientific evidence of the harms of tobacco? Well, I would assume that Singer was paid for this work, but that's not the key part of the story in my view. The key part, I think, comes from his own words. So in the introduction to this report, he explains why it's important to push back against the EPA, and he says, quote, "If we do not carefully delineate the government's role in regulating dangers, there's essentially no limit to how much government can ultimately control our lives." And in our book and in our films, we document many, many examples of this argument. If we allow the government to regulate X, then soon it will also regulate Y and Z, and we will lose our freedom. Acid rain today, the Bill of Rights tomorrow. This argument comes directly from the work of the Chicago economist Milton Friedman. And it's an argument that I call the capitalism and freedom argument. And indeed, we've seen this argument being resurrected in the last few months. It was used by Ronald Reagan in the 1990s to justify lower taxation, less government, and to foster marketplace deregulation. And that set of arguments has really been guiding conservative thinking in the United States since the Reagan administration. The two key texts are Milton Friedman's book by that name, Capitalism and Freedom, which was inspired in turn by the work of the Austrian neoliberal economist Friedrich von Hayek. So if you're interested in this problem, these are the two books that you need to read to understand the intellectual framework that is guiding this whole argument. But if you go back to von Hayek, his basic argument is, he's making this argument towards the end of World War II, and he's saying if we allow Western democracies to have national health insurance or other forms of intervention in the marketplace, we're going to be on the road to serfdom, and it's only a matter of time. It's a kind of inevitable, there'll be an inevitable creeping of government control into different aspects of life. So this is the common thread of science denial, and in fact, the common thread between climate change, acid rain, tobacco, and other things that otherwise might seem to be totally different issues. That scientists discover a problem, typically inadvertently. I mean, the scientists who were working on acid rain didn't set out to discover acid rain. They were studying forest ecology and watershed hydrology. But scientists discover a problem, and the solution to this problem appears to require some sort of government action, whether it's putting a price on carbon or banning CFCs or limiting sulfur emissions from coal-fired power plants. And so people who don't want that government action, either for economic reasons or philosophical ones, question the science and attack the scientists. Sociologists call this implicatory denial. You deny something because you don't like its implications. And it's a common pattern in human life. It's not restricted to climate change denial. But if you deny the evidence that your partner is having an affair, maybe that's okay, life goes on. If you deny the evidence that the climate is changing, the consequences are pretty serious. So science has been politicized, to bring this now back to our question. Science has been politicized as a means to undermine it by groups and individuals who do not like what they interpret to be the political implications of our scientific findings. So here's the crucial point, though. When scientists were attacked, when the scientists who worked on tobacco or acid rain or the ozone hole were attacked, it wasn't because they had crossed the line into policy. Most of the scientists who were attacked in these stories that we wrote about had actually not played any role in public policy at all. They had done what most of us think we're supposed to do, do important work, publish it in peer-reviewed journals, talk about it in meetings. But their scientific research had revealed or affirmed serious problems like deaths from tobacco use or the threat to life on Earth from ozone depletion. So these scientists did not become targets because they had spoken out. They became targets because of the importance and significance of their work. So I think that many of us in the scientific community have actually misinterpreted cause and effect. The causal arrow is the reverse of what most of us think. Now, it is true that today there are some climate scientists like Mike Mann and like Jim Hansen who have spoken out, who have become public figures, but even these men, even Mike Mann and Jim Hansen, both of whom I know, they became public figures after they were attacked. They were scientists doing science, they got attacked, and being attacked made them decide that they needed to stand up and be counted. So it may help to understand this also to know that there's actually a very long history in the United States of claiming that government intervention in the marketplace threatens our freedom. And this is from some new work I'm doing now, trying to understand the deeper roots of this argument, which it turns out go back to at least the 1920s. And one of the ironies of this is that these arguments have actually often been used to protect products, profits, and in some cases actually to restrict competition, even when people are claiming to support, you know, a free market society. So I just thought, this is such a very interesting advertisement that I found. And I thought I would ask you, what do you think this might be an ad for? And my postdoc's not allowed to answer, but anybody else? Yeah, barbed wire, that's the usual answer. Sometimes people say hats. The answer is privately generated electricity. This was part of an ad campaign run in the early 1960s by a group of private sector electrical utilities who did not want the federal government to generate electricity at the Hoover Dam or other places in the United States. Now, we can argue about the benefits of government electricity, but the point is to see that the argument is not being made is not about the merits of different ways of generating electricity. The argument is this fear-mongering campaign that if we allow the government to generate electricity, pretty soon we'll be living behind barbed wire. So what does all of this tell us about facts and values? Well, we see that in all these stories, the facts and values are conflated and complicated in difficult ways that are difficult to sort out. But the key insight, I think, is to understand that these arguments are not about the scientific facts. And because they're not about facts, they can't be refuted with facts. But they can be addressed with political or historical evidence or with other arguments about values. So, for example, one thing we can do is to challenge the assertion that addressing climate change necessarily requires bigger government or higher taxes. And a good example of this is the history of acid rain. So some people in the audience here I know remember that acid rain, which was a very serious problem, was addressed in the 1990s through amendments to the Clean Air Act that created emissions trading, a market-based mechanism that was supported by both Democrats and Republicans and signed into law by Republican President George H.W. Bush. This law did not lead to the expansion of the federal government. It did not lead to higher taxes, nor did it lead to a loss of liberty of people living in the Midwest where acid rain was a problem. And in fact, the price of electricity in the American Midwest fell. The second thing I think that's important for us to think about is that I think we shouldn't be afraid to address values. For two reasons. First of all, because these are values questions, we have to address the values involved. If we just keep throwing more facts on people, it won't address the worry, the concern that they have. So if our fellow citizens in South Dakota, Ohio, or Oklahoma are worried about bigger government or worried about values, then we have to be able to talk about that. And I think that preventing disruptive climate change actually lines up with the fundamental values that many of our fellow Americans share. In fact, I think it lines up with more values that many of our fellow Americans share than simply the value of constraining big government. So think about it. The value of fairness, which includes protecting innocent people from getting hurt. We controlled secondhand smoke in part because there was so much overwhelming evidence that secondhand smoke hurt children. And that was one of the very powerful arguments that was made for the right of the EPA to regulate secondhand smoke in order to prevent hurt or harm to innocent people like non-smokers and children who were not choosing to smoke. Or the value of accountability, that the people who made a problem have an obligation to address it. Or the value of being realistic, of accepting that market failure is a reality, and sometimes there is the need for the government to nudge the market in the right direction. We saw that during the housing crisis, we've seen it in the financial crisis. People know that markets don't always work the way we want them to. Or the value of technological leadership and hard work, of rolling up our sleeves and getting the job done, something that Americans have always done and prided themselves in doing. And of course, most importantly is the argument that there are values that the market does not protect, like the basic inherent dignity of all people. And this is the central argument that Pope Francis makes in the encyclical on climate change and inequality, that there is an inherent dignity to all humans, and that that is something that we all have a right to defend and protect. Freedom is important, but so are many other things. And in the long run, climate change deniers are not actually protecting our freedom. In fact, they're threatening it. And this, I think, is one of the most powerful arguments we can make, that while the climate change deniers say freedom, 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 which they do, in reality, the shoe is on that other foot. So I want to just show you one other clip from the film where I'm speaking and addressing this issue. As sea level rises and hurricanes become more intense, people get killed, their houses and communities get destroyed. Or think about heat waves and droughts that ruin agricultural communities. All of these are problems that it will require government intervention to address. The great irony of this story, to me, is that people who don't like big government are going to get more of it. And we're going to see more money being spent on dealing with the aftermath of these disasters. There will be billions of dollars in real estate losses, but more than that, people will die. That's why it matters. That's why this is meaningful for us and not just for polar bears or people in Bangladesh. that's why so many people in the scientific community now are really starting to talk in very worried tones, because there's, I think, a growing sense in the scientific community that we're running out of time to prevent a train wreck. So, obviously, my argument is that we do need to speak up, because we need to counter the disinformation, the misinformation, and the false value arguments that are being made by other people. But I want to end with one more thought, which gets back to this idea of epistemic proximity. So if we go back to Roger Revelle in the 1960s, Revelle spoke up because he knew about something, the possibility of disruptive climate change, that few other people were aware of. And like Bohr and Einstein and Bethe before them, Revelle and Killing and their colleagues were speaking from their proximate expertise, speaking about something that they understood by virtue of their expertise as scientists that other people did not understand. But they also respected the expertise of others to propose and formulate the solutions. And Revelle worked on climate change his whole life. He studied it from many different angles. But he always was very cautious about any response to a question about what the right policy solution was. And I think this points to an important distinction. And it's not the fact-value distinction, as people have normally understood it, but it is related to it. It's about the limits of expertise. It's about who really knows how to fly that plane. So there are many things which, as natural scientists or social scientists, depending on what our expertise is, there are many things which we're not experts about and not particularly qualified to speak about. So in the case of climate change, if you're a climate scientist, if you do work on the physical science of climate change, you're not particularly knowledgeable in most cases about the social and economic aspects of impacts or the details of policy. Earth scientists can say that if we're to prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference in the climate system, which is what the UN Framework Convention commits us to, then we must do something to control greenhouse gases, because greenhouse gases and deforestation are the causes of this problem, just as CFCs were the causes of ozone depletion and secondhand smoke was the cause of lung cancer in otherwise healthy non-smokers. And that means preventing the continued dumping of CO2 into the atmosphere. That is a conclusion that falls directly from our science. We could call it a direct deductive consequence. And therefore, I want to argue we should not hesitate to say things that fall out directly from our scientific knowledge and understanding. Indeed, I would argue that it is our responsibility to do so, because we are the people who have that epistemic proximity, who understand the problem best. And in my model for this, then, I said in the beginning I was going to put forward an idea of the responsible scientist, and I think we have a model of someone who played that role in the United States, and that's Sherry Rowland, who won the Nobel Prize in the mid-1990s for his work accurately predicting that chlorinated fluorocarbons would deplete stratospheric ozone. In the 1980s, Rowland and his colleagues realized that unless we controlled CFCs, then destruction of stratospheric ozone would threaten the future of life on Earth. And because of that, he began to speak publicly. And like his nuclear physics colleagues beforehand, he became an advocate for action to control these chemicals that were the cause of ozone depletion. So for him, policy was a deductive consequence. Rowland felt that he could and should do this because the need to control CFCs was a direct consequence of the scientific work. So we can think of the argument as going like this: CFCs destroyed ozone. Stratospheric ozone protects life on Earth. So if we want to protect life on Earth, if we want life to continue, we must somehow control CFCs. Now, this did involve an implicit value premise, but that value premise was the value of life on Earth. And really, who was going to challenge that? I mean, that's a debate that I'd be happy to take on with any climate change denier. But here's the important point. His advocacy didn't undermine his scientific credibility. He did his key work in the 70s and early 80s, and he became an advocate for action in the middle to later 80s, and played a role, actually, in the development of the Montreal Protocol to control the substances that deplete stratospheric ozone. And in 1995, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for this work, along with Paul Crutzen and Mario Molina. I think that, if anything, there's an argument to say that his advocacy actually cemented his scientific legacy, that we know more about Sherry Rowland's scientific work today, in part because of what he did as a responsible scientist. So is there a comparable position for climate scientists? Yes, absolutely. Greenhouse gases are causing climate change. Climate change is dangerous. As I say in the film, it threatens people's lives, it threatens our homes, our well-being, our prosperity, and it also threatens polar bears and many other species, coral reefs and others. So if we want to protect humans and other species from the damages of disruptive climate change, then we must dramatically reduce and eventually phase out greenhouse gas emissions. And this is a deductive consequence that follows logically from our scientific work. But, however, as natural scientists, we don't have the expertise to answer questions such as, which is better, a carbon tax or an emissions trading system? If we go for an emissions trading system, should it be revenue neutral? Sorry, if we go for a carbon tax, should it be revenue neutral? And if so, should we do it through fee and dividend or through cutting tariffs and taxes elsewhere? And how useful are feed-in tariffs in stimulating renewable energy production? Should we focus on grid integration or energy storage? And what about nuclear power? These are all matters of social science, law, policy, and politics. It doesn't mean we can't have an opinion on these questions. Of course, as citizens, we can. And Jim Hansen has a right to be an advocate for the fee and dividend system if he wants to as a citizen. But I do think it's important for us to be clear about the limits of our own expertise, because let's face it, we aren't the people, well, unless you have a pilot's license, we aren't the people to fly that plane. So I want to argue that we should be reticent about areas outside our expertise. We should respect the expertise of others who are expert in those domains, whether they're economists, psychologists, lawyers, or other natural scientists. And if we want to address these topics because we've concluded that they're essential to the solution, then we should forge collaborations with colleagues in those domains. Put another way, if we expect people to respect our expertise, then we also have to respect theirs. That seems like common sense. But we should not be reticent about talking about the things we know and understand, the things we know to be true. And we should not be reticent about calling out others who say things that we know to be untrue. Experience of the past several decades has shown that when it comes to facts about the natural world, there are many people prepared to speak against the facts for many diverse reasons. And therefore, someone has to speak for the facts, and that someone, I think, is us. Thank you very much.
So who's going to the science march? That was wonderful. If there are any questions, please ask them.
Yes. To call on people. Yeah. Oh. Oh, here we go.
Thank you. Is this on? Yes. Oh, boy. It's very on.
Yes.
So I'm a great admirer of your work, and I found your chain of logic persuasive this evening, but loses me at one point. You suggest, but never quite say, that if more climate scientists spoke out about climate change, it would make a difference. So, to put it in question form, do you believe that, in spite of evidence that Peter Frumhoff speaks out, James McCarthy writes letters to the Globe last week, Somerville, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Many climate scientists are speaking out. It's not clear to me what difference that's making.
Yeah, that's a fair question. Of course, with anything involving social change, you know, these are very hard things to judge. What makes a difference? What moves the needle? But I think that if you think about it, I mean, you named four or five people, and I could probably name four or five more. But, you know, there are something like 10,000 climate scientists in America, and when we think about the people who've spoken out, the same dozen names comes to mind all the time. And, you know, I've served on committees that give out prizes for climate science communication, and I can tell you that the lists of people that get nominated are distressingly small. So I think that actually the numbers of people who have really been involved, making the effort, are small compared to the pool of people who are potentially available to do the work. And I think it's very important to have a larger pool for a couple of reasons. One is that we know, we do have good evidence from social science research about the so-called trusted messenger problem. People respond to messages in part based on who's telling it. And that makes it really important that it isn't just a couple of people. It isn't just Jim Hansen and Richard Somerville and Peter Frumhoff, much as I love all of those people. No, I don't love Jim Hansen. No, just kidding. much as I honor and respect all three of those men. We need more different people. And you know, everyone talks about Catherine Hayhoe now because she's this famous evangelical Christian scientist. And it's absolutely fabulous what Catherine is doing. But I mean, she is so incredibly lonely. And she's not the only climate scientist in America who is a religious believer. So why are we always talking about Catherine Hayhoe? I mean, where are the other Christian scientists, not Christian scientists, but scientists who are Christians? I mean, where are they, right? And we know, we do have evidence from the evolution debate that it does make a difference. When students hear about, and the person doesn't even have to come to class. There was a great talk at AAAS just last month or whenever we were there. I don't know, like time has stood still since Donald Trump got elected. But there was this great talk about an experiment that faculty at ASU have done where in class, in a biology class, they talk about scientists, evolutionary biologists who are also Christians like Ken Miller at Brown. And it doesn't, you don't need Ken to come to the class. Just talking about it, just having the students read something that he wrote about how he personally recognizes his religious faith with his scientific work, that makes a difference in how students receive the scientific information that they're getting. So we have evidence to say that it does make a difference. And so, and again, though, it's not just about writing a letter to the editor. I think the evidence also tells us that no, I don't think writing more letters to the Boston Globe is the key thing right now. Forgive me, but that is how I feel. But I think getting out, talking to people in communities, explaining to people why, how you became a climate scientist, what you've learned, and why it matters to people in the places they live, I think we do have evidence that that can make a difference. We also know that most people, when they vote, you know, they're not voting about, people didn't vote for Donald Trump because he said climate change was a hoax. Right? But part of the problem is that people don't see climate change as a problem that affects them and their lives. So we need to do more to talk about what the relationship is between climate change and jobs and storms that do affect you or that affect your crops. And that's a message that I think has not been articulated nearly as fully as it needs to be. Yeah. Oh, sorry, we're on that side. Okay, we're supposed to alternate sides. I don't know who I'm talking to. Oh, hi. Yeah, good.
We have the mic here.
Good.
I wonder if you could clarify something that just didn't focus quite for me, mostly in the last part of your talk. You said you distinguished science from the values, and you said the people who are the deniers are really motivated by values. They associate their position with freedom and so on. Now, are you saying that the scientists should get in a debate with them about values? You quickly outlined a few values like fairness and accountability and so on, but the scientists aren't expert about values necessarily.
Right.
And besides which, the deniers, it's not like they're leading with their values. Mm. They're denying the science, and that's something the scientists do know. So how much do you want the scientists to be talking about values and why?
Okay, that's a great question. I think you're right, because this is tricky. So the point is, though, when climate change deniers attack the science and scientists then try to answer it with science, it doesn't work. Because first of all, now you're in a debate about the science, and that just, one of the claims of climate change denial is that the science is unsettled and there's a big debate. So if you participate in a debate, now they've won because you've demonstrated that there's a debate. And we learned this again in the evolution situation too. If an evolutionary biologist debates a creationist, the evolutionary biologist always loses because what the audience hears is, oh, there's a big debate, we don't really know. So the debate framework when you're debating science just doesn't work. So then the question is, well, what are some of the alternatives? And so what I'm trying to get at, and it is a little subtle, so maybe I didn't explain clearly, is to expose, to say, look, I understand that there's a value premise here, right? And I understand that you don't want to see the expansion of big government. So let's talk about how we could solve this with small government solutions. So it's a way of shifting the argument. And then I think a scientist can talk about values if they are your own values. Because we all have values. You don't have to be an expert on values to talk about your values. So one of the things I do sometimes is I do talk about accountability. And I say, look, most of us believe in accountability. So let's talk about who made this problem and who's got the responsibility to fix it. Because one of the strategies that we've also seen being used is the idea that this is the fault of China or India, right? And so it's a way of saying, well, let's talk about the US contribution to climate change. We made this problem, but we also can fix it. And we can fix it through technological innovation, and then we can move the conversation into a discussion about grid integration and energy storage, and then that moves the conversation where I want it. Because I don't want to be debating whether or not climate change is happening. I want to be debating how do we get better grid integration and energy storage. And then I've got the conversation where I want it to be. And then I can talk to my audience about all this cool stuff that's going on in the technological domain and all the jobs that are being created in green energy in this country, which it turns out almost nobody knows about. Here's a good question. Again, my postdoc is not allowed to answer, but how many jobs do you think there are in coal in the United States? Okay. Most estimates say between 20 and 30,000. So this is a highly educated audience, and even you think it's much more than it is. Most people will tell you a million or 500,000, right? There are actually incredibly few jobs in coal mining in this country, despite all the fussing and rhetoric that we've been hearing about the war on coal, right? How many jobs do we have now, today, not in the future, but today, in renewable energy? Anybody care to guess? 500,000? Okay, this is a ridiculously educated audience. This doesn't work as well. The correct answer, though, even in this wildly educated Harvard audience, 3.5 million. Yeah, who knows that? So that's the point. We want to be take. If people are worried about jobs, let's talk about jobs, because actually we have really good evidence on that job front. So that does that kind of clarify it a bit? Good. Okay, thank you. Hi.
And okay.
This to someone over here.
I don't want this to get into a debate about religion, but I do have a point to make, or okay. A question to ask. I'm actually from Texas. Don't worry, I'm on your side. And
that's all right.
I'm a science advocate among my people.
Some of my best friends are Texans.
My family is chocked full of very religious people. My dad's a Southern Baptist minister. Most of the people in my family are in the ministry. And when I talk to them about this stuff, they don't deny the science. They deny that we'll be here long enough for it to matter.
Yeah.
They keep telling me that, don't worry, Jesus is coming. And so I wonder where the argument is, what the point we can make is, and you know, if there's hope for even any progress with these kind of people.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything you can do, honestly. No, really. I mean, I'm teaching science and religion in America today, and one of the things that's so interesting about religious belief in America is how incredibly diverse it is. But if people are millenarians who believe that Jesus is coming, it's all going to end pretty soon anyway, I'm not really sure there's much of an argument you can make that would change those people's minds. So it might be better to just move on and work on, you know, I mean, Texas already has a feed-in tariff for wind power, but to think about, you know, things you could do to support renewable energy that people might support for other reasons, like it's economically sensible or some other issue that they might like. I don't know. I'm sorry, what? Sorry. What was that, what? Right, but if you think it's all about to end, right? I mean, if you really, and especially, no, but I mean, this does raise an important issue. I mean, one of the challenges that scientists often face is that things that for us are clearly evidence to support our theories are not necessarily evidence of that for other people. So if you have an eschatological philosophy and you do believe that the world is about to end, then the intensification of hurricanes, heating of the ocean, death of coral reefs, things that for us are clearly evidence of climate disruption, for those people could be evidence that we're really getting close. So you can't really win that argument, right? And so you might just decide, you know, you need to move on, right? But the fact is, let's face it, I mean, political change doesn't come because everyone agrees on everything. Political change comes because enough people agree on enough things. And so I think that's where, again, there are people who are evangelical Christians who might disagree with me on a whole heck of a lot of things, but still might be willing to support solar power because they could see the way in which it might empower their communities, right? Or they might see the way it could bring jobs to their communities. So, yeah. Oh, sorry, you're next. Okay, go ahead.
Hi, about a month ago, I went to Denver for 3 days of training with Al Gore's group, the Climate Reality Project. And as part of this free training, I've got an obligation to participate or be involved or organize 10 events during the year.
Oh, gosh.
And as I was thinking about how to meet my obligations, one thing that occurred to me was to turn to my work. I work for a national company in healthcare. It's a $1 billion company. So I sent an email to the owner of the company, and he said, oh, sure, let's talk about it. I had a conversation with him yesterday in which he said, well, you know, this is a really good thing, but I'm concerned about the political angle. Some of our customers and employees might not agree with the message. So as we talked over about half an hour, I was able to pull him around to thinking about this. Well, this is a green initiative. We're doing something good that's going to benefit, you know, people. So we take it out of the political angle. Well, today, Michael Mann gets into it with Lamar Smith and with Judith Curry at the House Science Committee meetings, and it's going to be in the New York Times tomorrow, and my boss is going to read that. Mm-hmm. So we've got this political environment going on that's making it difficult for people to take positions because they're afraid of the polarization. You're out there speaking, Catherine Hayhoe is, Michael Mann is, but where are the rest of the scientists?
Well, I mean, that was the question we had earlier, right? And that is part of my argument, is that I think that more people and more diverse people need to be involved in this issue. And the more different kinds of people are out there talking, the less this would look like it would just be a particular political point of view. I mean, the hearing today was an interesting one. I got approached by the committee last week. And, you know, I mean, this is theater, right? So we have to borrow from our colleagues in the theater department and think about how do you respond to a theatrical performance. And so what I recommend, and it was too late because they'd already invited Mike to come, and that's okay, Mike's great, but I said don't invite a scientist to respond, right? This is a charade. You know, I mean, it's ridiculous. You can find three people to say almost anything anywhere if you look hard enough. I think what you should do is just fill the chair with all the reports, you know, all the government reports, all the IPCC reports, just stack them up and have a giant pile and say that's our response, right? You know, so, you know, we could begin to think creatively. We don't have to just be pulled in all the time to these, you know, frameworks that we know are wrong and misleading, but we do get sucked into them, and it's hard not to, right? It's hard not to think. I mean, it was an interesting moment for me when I realized the House Science Committee, well, the minority, is calling me, and I'm telling them, don't get a scientist to testify, you know, just bring in a pile of reports, right? And after I wrote that, you know, I said that, I hung up the phone, I thought, wow, that's an interesting moment, right? So, but I mean, we do have to be creative. We have to think differently about this, I think, than we have in the past. Thank you.
Actually related to what you just addressed, but so I'm a PhD student at this point without much public visibility or platform, and I'm just curious what you think are positive and productive venues for scientists to express their expertise to affect real change.
Go to a local school, go talk in your church. I mean, we're all part of organizations and networks, and I think what you said about your job and your work is a really important insight. Sometimes we think we don't have access because we don't get invited to Congress or we don't get invited. But, you know, public opinion isn't really being made on the front page of the New York Times as much as the editors of the New York Times would like to think that it is. You know, public opinion is being made by people talking to their friends and their neighbors and in their churches and in their synagogues and in their mosques and in their community groups. So there are opportunities to reach out to people all the time, but we sometimes don't see them because we take for granted what's, you know, around us. So I would say, you know, wherever you live, maybe the local library has a lecture series that you could volunteer to speak in. Or give me your phone number and I will tell them to invite you. And I mean, seriously, I get so many more invitations than I could possibly handle. And I'm always looking for other colleagues who I can suggest. So if you want to do talks, let me know and I'll send, you know, I mean, obviously not everything I get invited to do, you know, they'll take a substitute, but sometimes they will. But the point is there are all kinds of opportunities. And, you know, I was thinking about this the other day about being a Harvard professor, and I'm going to South Dakota State tomorrow. You know, I think if most of us get invited to speak at Princeton or Chicago or Caltech, of course we go because we see the obvious value for our professional stature to do that. But I think that a lot of colleagues, if they got invited to go to South Dakota State, would just say no thanks, I'm busy, right? And my thinking about that is completely inverted now. I mean, I should say myself, 15 years ago, I would have probably thought that. Now it's the other way around. I get invited to go to Princeton, I say, you guys don't need me. South Dakota State, they need me, right? So where I'm going to speak, what I'm accepting now is very different than even 5 years ago, because I'm really thinking in terms of places where outreach could make more of a difference. So I'm not doing any teach-ins in Cambridge. I've already told people that, in case anyone's thinking about it, because I don't think this is where we need the action. And I think that all of us should be thinking about what are our points of connection to places where it could make a difference. And that, for a lot of us, means not on the Harvard campus, but it might be in our communities, because lots of us live in places where, as I said, people might not be climate deniers, but they may not be very engaged in understanding why this issue is important.
So let's just have two more questions. Is that okay?
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you.
And then I'm sure Naomi would be happy to...
Do what? Go home and have a good night's sleep? Yeah. Okay.
There are other contexts in which scientists are asked to make moral choices. A couple of years ago, Stephen Hawking refused to attend a major conference in Israel because he was asked to observe the academic boycott there. Should scientists take a moral stand on very pressing issues of the day if it's not directly related to their field of inquiry, even though it entails a moral obligation in which some of their activities may come in contact with the circumstances that are resulting in various forms of repression and human suffering?
Look, I mean, I can't tell other people what to do. I think those kinds of issues are quite difficult and vexed, and people have to decide for themselves. But in general, my view would be no. I do think that as climate scientists or as toxicologists or as marine biologists or whatever our field is, that we have a particular role to play as experts. I mean, that's why I use the cartoon about flying the plane. And that's what I'm really most interested in. Now, of course, as human beings, we're going to be making choices all the time about what we think are moral or immoral. Or we might make choices about our own safety. Like, I mean, speaking of Texas, I've been to Texas more than once, but I do have reservations now about going back now that Texan universities are allowing students to carry guns on campus. I mean, I find that very problematic and actually potentially a threat to my own personal safety. So I think that we might make choices. We might decide in particular situations that we might not go somewhere because it offends our personal sensibilities or because we think it threatens our safety. Or we might just feel that we just need to take a stand. But at the same time, there's always that question of who you're hurting, right? Because when I went to Houston, I guess it was a year or two ago, it was right around the time that the legislature was debating that thing about carrying guns on campus, and I actually almost didn't go. And of course, my colleagues there said the obvious thing, which is if you don't come, you'll hurt us, right? We want to hear you. Our students need to hear you. So, you know, what good does it do if you don't come, right? So there's always that question about who are you impacting through your actions. So I think when you get out and when you talk to people and when you try to be, to listen and be empathetic and understand people's questions and answer them honestly and take people's questions seriously, that's almost always a good thing to do. When you say, I can't go here because of X or Y, I think that's much more complicated and much more fraught.
Okay, my name is Andrew Bergman. I'm a PhD student here in applied physics and a member of a new group called the Environmental Data and Governance Initiative. And this question is something I'm experiencing, but I'll frame it in terms of the conversation about climate change. I think that sometimes what I notice, and it's sort of related to this question, but more explicitly about expertise within a very specific field. You know, even when you say someone is a climate scientist, that is a lot of different types of scientists working on a totally disparate set of issues. And sometimes, you know, when you go testify in Congress, you're talking about the general science of climate. But the specificity with which, you know, people like Oppenheimer and others, you know, really understood the nuclear physics they were working on doesn't necessarily apply in the same sort of general way to climate scientists. And I support, you know, scientists who have sort of peripheral or solid understanding advocating. But when we want the specific sort of expertise driven, sort of, as you said, like somebody who really is an expert has a very different platform on which they can stand and speak, should we as a scientific community be more discerning and actually say, like, you know, when you decide to speak out as an expert, be clear about the specificity of your expertise and don't show up to, you know, schools or Congress and say you're an expert just because you have a degree in physics. I mean, I don't think, when my friends ask me, you know, tell me about climate science, I say, I really don't know. I'm trusting other scientists. And that's the reality.
This is a really important point. Thank you for raising it. So one of the reasons why I've been thinking about this whole issue of proximate expertise is because it's actually essential if we're going to be able to refute merchants of doubt type claims, right? Because one of the ways that the whole doubt mongering strategy works is to recruit scientists to be part of this, right? And that was a key strategy that the tobacco industry invented, which was to find scientists to come and speak. Now, in many cases, those people were actually scientists of some kind. They had some kind of scientific training, but they weren't oncologists. They weren't public health officials. They weren't physicians. And Fred Singer, who I talked about, is a classic case in point. I mean, the man was a very intelligent, very highly educated person, but he knew nothing about cancer or bronchitis or emphysema or epidemiology or any of the disciplines that could have been potentially relevant to that case. And that's the key point about what you're saying. So when it comes to climate science, there are many disciplines that are relevant, and there are many angles from which you might enter into the topic with legitimate, strong expertise. Just as with tobacco, you could have been a physician, you could have been an epidemiologist, you could have been an oncologist. Many different expertises could have been relevant there, and Singer had none of them. So that should have been a red flag. It should have been a red flag to his colleagues. It should have been a red flag to the media. But it's not, in part because we don't discern. And that is why I think it's so important that we are discerning and that we also exercise a certain amount of restraint, right? So, and I work hard, really hard on this because I get asked about all kinds of things. And, you know, just the other day I got asked this question. I went and talked to the EPS graduate students and someone wanted to talk about immigration. And the first thing I said is, I feel like I know a lot of things and immigration isn't one of them. And I don't feel like, you know, and I just said, let's talk about other things, right? So being able to say, it's not my area, I really don't know. If I answer that question, I'd just be giving you my personal opinion. I think that's really important. Now that said though, there is one other nuance to add to this. Expertise is not absolute, it's relative. So depending on the context, it might be that even though you're a physicist, you might actually be pretty knowledgeable about evolutionary biology. Maybe you've even read The Origin of Species. And if somebody asked you a question about it, you might be able to say, well, look, I'm not an evolutionary biologist, but I do know certain things. Or something I sometimes say when I'm asked, I'm not an economist, you know, but some of my best friends are economists. No, but my economics colleagues say that carbon pricing is one of the most effective things we could do, you know, to level a playing field and pay the true cost, not the price, but the cost of carbon, right? So you can invoke the authority of other experts that you know or that you've read, and then that invites your audience to say, okay, so if we want to learn more about this, you know, next year we invite an economist to come and speak to you. And you can even give them the names. You could say, well, I am friends with Nick Stern, and here's what Nick says about it, right? And that's, I think, legitimate because you've talked to the person, you've paid attention to their arguments. One time years ago when I was talking to a group of graduate students, a student, and I forget, she was studying coral reefs, or it was something to do with marine biology, and she said that she was in a choral group, a singing group, in which one of the other people in the group had asked her about climate change, and it was some element of climate change that was quite far away from what she worked on. And she said she felt really awkward because she felt like she wasn't an expert. But I said to her, you know, that's true. You're not an expert on, you know, tropospheric warming. But in that group, you are the local expert. And people are turning to you because they know that you're getting a PhD. This was at UC Davis. And they know you're at Davis. They know Davis is a good school. And by asking you, they're actually saying that they trust you. They want to know what you know about this. And in that situation, I think it is reasonable to say, well, it's not my specialty, but, you know, here's what I know. And I think that, so, you know, expertise is contextual and relative, and And it's about, in a way, it's just about being thoughtful about where your limits of expertise are and being honest about that. And when it goes too far, to say, okay, that, you know, I really can't answer that. I'm sorry. Right?
So.
And on that note, I can't answer.
On that note.